Randy Stephen Kraft was born in Long Beach, California, on March 19, 1945, the fourth child and only son born to Opal Lee and Harold Herbert Kraft. Kraft's parents had moved to California from Wyoming at the outbreak of World War II. His father worked as a production worker, and his mother worked as a sewing machine operator. The Kraft family lived modestly, and Kraft's mother undertook a succession of jobs to supplement her husband's salary. Nonetheless, Opal Kraft always found time for her children, whereas in contrast, Kraft's father seldom attended any social gatherings with them, and was later described as being distanced from his family. As a child, Randy was doted on by his three older sisters and mother, although he was known to be accident-prone. In 1948, the Kraft family moved from Long Beach to Midway City, in neighboring Orange County. Their home was a small, wood-frame Women's Army Corps dormitory on Beach Boulevard that Kraft's father renovated into a three-bedroom house. In Midway City, Kraft attended Midway City Elementary School, where his mother served on the PTA. As a student, he was noted for his intelligence by classmates and teachers. By 1957, Kraft was deemed intelligent enough to attend accelerated classes at 17th Street Junior High School. Adolescence and Graduation. Edit by adolescence, Kraft had taken a keen interest in politics, becoming a staunch Republican with aspirations of becoming a U.S. Senator. Shortly after his enrollment at Westminster High School, he and two close friends founded a Westminster World Affairs Club. At Westminster High, Kraft was again regarded as a pleasant, bright student who regularly achieved A grades. He was also known to occasionally date girls, although some classmates and teachers later stated they suspected Kraft was homosexual. Kraft later stated he had known from his high school days that he was homosexual, although he initially kept his sexual orientation a secret. On June 13, 1963, he graduated 10th out of a class of 390 pupils. That fall, he enrolled at Claremont Men's College in Claremont, California, where he pursued a Bachelor of Arts degree in economics. Shortly after his enrollment at Claremont Men's College, now named Claremont McKenna College, Kraft enrolled in the Claremont Reserve Officers Training Corps and regularly attended demonstrations in support of the Vietnam War and, in 1964, for the election of Republican presidential candidate Barry Goldwater. Kraft later declared these actions were merely a mimic of his parents' political views and not his own, describing his second year at Claremont as being when he abandoned the last gasp of his conservative ideology. The same year, Kraft entered his first known homosexual relationship. In 1964, Kraft began working as a bartender at a local Garden Grove cocktail lounge that catered to gay clientele. He was also known to regularly travel to Laguna Beach and Huntington Beach to have casual sex with hustlers. In an apparent tentative effort to announce his sexuality to his parents, Kraft took a succession of male friends to meet his family in the years he was enrolled at Claremont. Initially, Kraft's parents and sisters were oblivious to his homosexuality. In 1966, Kraft was arrested and charged with lewd conduct after propositioning an undercover policeman in Huntington Beach. As he had no previous criminal record, no charges were filed. The following year, he developed a radical shift in his political beliefs, becoming an ardent supporter of left-wing politics, and eventually registered as a Democrat in 1967. The same year he registered as a Democrat, Kraft became a party organizer, campaigning tirelessly for the election of Robert F. Kennedy and receiving a personal letter from the senator, thanking him for his efforts. By his senior year, he had become a lackadaisical student, drinking, taking drugs, and regularly attending all-night gambling and poker sessions with other students. The lack of commitment to his studies in his final year resulted in Kraft's failing to graduate from Claremont in June 1967. Kraft had to repeat his econometrics class, resulting in deferment of his graduation by 8 months. In February 1968, he graduated from Claremont Men's College with a Bachelor of Arts in Economics. 4 months after his graduating from college, Kraft joined the U.S. Air Force. He was sent to basic training in Texas before being stationed at Edwards Air Force Base in Southern California, where he supervised the painting of test planes. In his service within the Air Force, Kraft rose to the rank of Airman First Class and Supervisor Manager. The same year Kraft became an Airman First Class, he disclosed to his family that he was homosexual. In a letter he wrote to a friend, Kraft described his father as having flown into a rage, whereas he described his mother as being more understanding, if somewhat disapproving. Kraft's family ultimately accepted his sexuality, and he remained in close contact with his parents and siblings, although his siblings noted he began to distance himself from his family after he had announced his sexuality to them. On July 26, 1969, Kraft received a general discharge from the Air Force after announcing his sexuality to his superiors. The discharge was officially listed as being on medical grounds. In response, Kraft sought legal advice from an attorney in an attempt to challenge the grounds regarding his discharge from the Air Force. The Air Force, however, refused to change the status of his discharge. Following his military discharge, Kraft moved back into his parents' home and worked as a bartender. In March 1970, Kraft encountered a 13-year-old Westminster youth named Joseph Gerald Fancher at Huntington Beach. Fancher explained to Kraft that he had run away from home that day. In response, Kraft invited the youth to accompany him to his apartment on the promise that Fancher could live with him. Fancher agreed and accompanied Kraft to his Belmont Shore apartment, where he was drugged and assaulted. Hours later, Fancher escaped from Kraft's apartment after Kraft left the youth unattended to go to work. A member of the public summoned an ambulance. Having observed Fancher's drugged and disheveled condition, he required having his stomach pumped as a result of the drugs he had ingested. At the hospital, Fancher informed police Kraft had given him drugs and beaten him. He did not disclose to either his parents or the police that he had been sexually assaulted. A search of Kraft's apartment was conducted, with the cooperation of his roommate. However, as Fancher had confessed to police he had taken the pills offered to him voluntarily and the officers had conducted the search without a warrant, no charges were filed. In 1971, Kraft found new employment as a forklift driver in Huntington Beach. In an effort to further his career prospects following his military discharge 2 years earlier, he enrolled at Long Beach State University, undertaking teaching courses. There, Kraft became acquainted with Jeff Graves, a fellow teaching student from Minnesota 4 years younger than Kraft, with whom he Between 1971 and 1983, Kraft is believed to have killed a total of 67 victims. All of his suspected victims were males between the ages of 13 and 35, the majority of whom were in their late teens to mid-20s. Kraft was charged with, and convicted of, 16 of these homicides, all of which had occurred between 1972 and 1983. Many of his victims had been enlisted in the United States Marines Corps, and most of his victims' bodies bore evidence of high levels of both alcohol and tranquilizers in their blood systems, indicating they had been rendered insensate before they had been abused and killed. Kraft's victims were typically lured into his vehicle with an offer of a lift or alcohol. Inside Kraft's vehicle, the victims would be plied with alcohol and/or other drugs. They were then bound, tortured, and sexually abused before they were usually killed by either strangulation, asphyxiation, or bludgeoning, although some victims had also ingested fatal doses of pharmaceuticals and at least one victim was stabbed to death. The victims would then be discarded, usually, though not exclusively, alongside or close to various freeways in Southern California. Photographic evidence found at Kraft's home indicates several of his victims were driven to his house before their murder. Many of the victims were burned with a car cigarette lighter, usually around the genitals, chest, and face, and several were found with extensive blunt force trauma to the face and head. In several instances, foreign objects were found inserted into the victims' rectums while other victims had suffered emasculation, or mutilation and dismemberment. The majority of Kraft's murders were committed in California, although some victims had been killed in Oregon, with two further known victims murdered in Michigan in December 1982. On October 5, 1971, police found the nude body of a 30-year-old Long Beach resident named Wayne Joseph Duquette discarded close to the Ortega Highway. Duquette, a bartender at a gay bar named The Stable in nearby Sunset Beach, had last been seen alive on September 20, 1971. Putrefaction had erased any signs of foul play upon the body, and the cause of death was listed as acute alcohol poisoning due to a high blood alcohol level. The first entry in Kraft's personal journal, referred to as his scorecard, reads Stable, leading investigators to believe Duquette was Kraft's first murder victim. 15 months after the murder of Duquette, Kraft killed a 20-year-old Marine named Edward Daniel Moore. Moore was seen alive leaving the barracks at Camp Pendleton on December 24, 1972. His body was found beside the 405 freeway in Seal Beach during the early hours of December 26. Abrasions on Moore's body indicated he had been discarded from a moving vehicle. An autopsy revealed he had been bound about the wrists and ankles, then beaten with a blunt instrument about the face before being garroted. His body also bore evidence of numerous bite marks, and a sock had been forced into his rectum. 6 weeks after the murder of Moore, on February 6, 1973, the body of an unidentified male, estimated to be around 17 to 25 years old, was found alongside the Terminal Island Freeway in Los Angeles. This victim had been strangled by a ligature and had also had a sock placed in his rectum. 2 months later, on April 9, the body of 17-year-old Kevin Clark Bailey was found beside a road in Huntington Beach. Bailey had been emasculated and sodomized prior to his murder. By July 28, a further two victims had been murdered: an unidentified youth whose dismembered body was found on April 22, and a 20-year-old named Ronnie Jean Wiebe, whose strangled body was discarded beside an on-ramp to the 405 freeway on July 30, 2 days after he had disappeared. Welt marks on Wiebe's wrists and ankles suggested he had been bound and suspended from a device before his murder. Kraft is only known to have killed once more in 1973. The victim was a 23-year-old bisexual art student named Vincent Cruz Mestres, whose body was found in the San Bernardino Mountains on December 29. As had been the case with several previous victims, one of the victim's socks had been forced into his rectum. Mestres's hands had also been severed from his body, and were never found. By November 1974, a further five victims had been found beside or close to mass transportation in Southern California, three of which had been conclusively linked to the same killer. Two of these victims, 20-year-old Malcolm Eugene Little and 19-year-old James Dale Reeves, had each been found beside a freeway with foreign objects inserted into their bodies, whereas the body of the third victim, 18-year-old Marine Roger Edward Dickerson, bore evidence of bite marks much like several earlier victims. On January 3, 1975, Kraft abducted and murdered a 17-year-old high school student named John Lerers. The youth was last seen boarding a bus in Long Beach. His strangled body was found the following day, discarded at Sunset Beach with a foreign object protruding from his anus. Drag marks along the beach close to where his body had been discarded indicated two individuals had carried Lerers's body into the water. 2 weeks after this murder, on January 17, the body of a 21-year-old named Craig Jonatus was found discarded in the parking lot of the Golden Sales Hotel near the Pacific Coast Highway and Loins Drive in Long Beach. Jonatus had been strangled to death with a length of string, possibly a shoelace. By January 1975, a total of 14 victims, whose bodies had been found discarded across four separate counties within the previous 3 years, had been linked to the same killer. All the victims had been Caucasian males with similar physical characteristics. On January 24, homicide investigators from several jurisdictions in Southern California convened in Orange County to discuss progress in the hunt for the unknown killer. An FBI profile of the killer was read to investigators, describing the individual as a methodical, organized lust killer of above-average intelligence who exhibited an indifference to the interests and welfare of society. Some investigators believed the murders to be the work of more than one individual, one or more of whom had a military background. Two victims' bodies had tissue paper residue on their noses, conforming to a known military procedure to prevent bodies from purging after death. The placing of socks inside the victims' rectums was also theorized to be a method used by the killer to prevent purging as the body was driven to the disposal location. At this stage, investigators had no solid suspects. On the evening of March 29, 1975, Kraft lured two youths, Keith Crotwell and Kent May, from a Long Beach parking lot into his Ford Mustang. The youths were plied with beer and Valium as Kraft drove in an apparently random, directionless manner around Belmont Shore and Seal Beach. May later recalled feeling catatonic as a result of the Valium and alcohol he had ingested before he passed out. In the parking lot where Crotwell and May had last been seen, two friends of the youths observed a distinctive black and white Mustang rapidly enter and draw to a halt before the driver leaned across, opened the passenger door, and pushed the unconscious, but otherwise unharmed, May from the rear seat onto the pavement. The driver then sped away from the scene. As he did so, the friends noted Crotwell slumped against the unknown driver's shoulder. On May 8, Crotwell's skull was found in a jetty close to the Long Beach Marina. The remainder of his body was found 6 months later. Upon hearing the news, the two friends of Crotwell and May, suspecting the murderer to have been a patron of a Belmont Shore gay bar, scoured their neighborhood for the distinctive Mustang they had observed. Upon locating the vehicle less than 1 mile from their home, the youths noted the license plate number and relayed the information to police. The registration of the vehicle was traced to Kraft. Long Beach police questioned Kraft about Crotwell's abduction and murder on May 19, 1975. Initially, he denied having ever met either Crotwell or May, and the police, initially skeptical of Kraft's denial, summoned him to the police station for further questioning. There, Kraft admitted that on or around March 29, he had encountered two youths in the Long Beach parking lot in question and had persuaded them to drink alcohol and consume Valium with him as he drove. He claimed to have returned May to the parking lot and then to have driven with Crotwell to a side road close to the El Toro ramp, where his car subsequently became embedded upon an embankment. He claimed to have walked alone to a gas station to call a tow truck while Crotwell remained with his vehicle. Upon returning to his vehicle, Kraft claimed Crotwell had disappeared. Although Kraft's roommate was able to verify to detectives that Kraft had phoned him on the date of Crotwell's disappearance, claiming his vehicle was stuck upon an embankment, detectives remained unconvinced with Kraft's overall version of events. The following week, two detectives attempted to file homicide charges against Kraft. However, the Los Angeles District's Attorney's Office dismissed the detectives' request, citing the coroner's conclusion from his autopsy of the remains thus far found, solely the youth's skull, that the youth had died of accidental drowning. Perhaps because Kraft had been questioned as a suspect in Crotwell's murder and because of additional turmoil in his personal life in the summer of 1975, Kraft is not known to have killed again until December 31, when he abducted 22-year-old Mark Hall in San Juan Capistrano. In this murder, later described by prosecutors as the worst of all of Kraft's known murders, the man was driven to a remote canyon, where he was bound to a tree. The autopsy report listed the cause of death as being asphyxiation caused by leaves and earth found lodged deep into Hall's trachea. The autopsy also revealed Hall had been sodomized and emasculated, with his severed genitals then inserted into his rectum. Additionally, his chest, scrotum, nose and cheeks had been burned with an automobile cigarette lighter, with his eyes being destroyed by the same object. Other injuries noted in the autopsy included numerous incisions on Hall's legs which had been inflicted with a broken bottle. Forensic experts were able to deduce that Hall had been alive throughout much of the ordeal. By 1976, Kraft had ended his relationship with Graves. Shortly thereafter, he began a relationship with a 19-year-old apprentice baker named Jeff Selig, and the couple moved to Laguna Hills. Although neither man was inclined towards monogamy, the couple considered their relationship permanent. Selig later informed investigators that he and Kraft regularly picked up and propositioned hitchhikers who, if willing, would accompany them to their apartment for a threesome. However, Selig was adamant that Kraft had never been violent towards him and that he had never seen him display violent tendencies. Kraft's relationship with Selig is believed to be a contributory factor in the sudden lull in murders he is known to have committed. He is not known to have killed again until December 10, 1976. The body of the victim, 19-year-old Paul Joseph Fuchs, has never been found. Nonetheless, Fuchs' name is clearly listed upon Kraft's scorecard. Following the December 1976 murder of Fuchs, Kraft is not known to have killed any further victims for 16 months. On January 3, 1978, homicide investigators again convened to discuss progress in relation to the manhunt for the still unidentified killer. By this stage, investigators knew there was more than one murderer at large. The previous July, police had arrested Patrick Carney, who subsequently confessed to the murders of 28 boys and young men, many of whom he had dissected and discarded in trash bags beside freeways in Southern California. Although Kraft had himself dismembered some of his victims' bodies, he never killed his victims by shooting them in the temple, as Carney had. Additionally, Carney had never tortured any of his victims. His modus operandi significantly differed from Kraft's, and investigators were certain that an altogether separate killer was still at large. On April 16, 1978, Kraft abducted an 18-year-old Marine named Scott Michael Hughes. Hughes was plied with Valium before Kraft slit open his scrotum and removed one of his testicles, then strangled him to death with a ligature before discarding his fully clothed body, missing only his shoelaces, besides a freeway on ramp in Anaheim. 2 months later, on June 11, the body of 23-year-old Roland Gerald Young was found near a San Diego freeway. Young had been emasculated before he was stabbed to death. Abrasions to his body indicated that he had been thrown from a vehicle traveling at high speed. 8 days later, the body of a 20-year-old Camp Pendleton Marine named Richard Allen Keith was found discarded beside a road in Moulton Parkway. Welts on Keith's wrists indicated that he had been bound before he was strangled with a ligature. Froth in his throat indicated that he was also drowning as a result of lorazepam and alcohol he had consumed at the time he was strangled. 3 weeks after the murder of Keith, on July 6, Kraft killed a 23-year-old hitchhiker named Keith Arthur Klingbl. Klingbl had ingested large doses of paracetamol and alcohol before he was strangled with his own shoelace and his body discarded beside the Interstate 5 freeway. Although Klingbl was still alive when discovered, he would die shortly after his admission to the Mission Community Hospital. A subsequent autopsy revealed that, prior to Klingbl's strangulation, his left nipple had been seared with an automobile cigarette lighter. 2 months later, on September 29, the body of 20-year-old Richard Anthony Crosby was found discarded 200 yards north of Highway 71 in San Bernardino County. Crosby had disappeared the previous day as he hitchhiked home from a theater in Torrance. The youth had died of suffocation, and his left nipple had been mutilated with an automobile cigarette lighter. The last known victim claimed by Kraft in 1978 was a 21-year-old Long Beach truck driver named Michael Joseph Inderbyerton, whose castrated body was found beside the San Diego freeway on November 18, 1978. In addition to having been castrated, Inderbyerton had been violated with a foreign object and had suffered burn wounds similar to those inflicted upon victim Mark Hall 2 years previously. The cause of death was listed as suffocation. Kraft is not known to have killed again until June 16, 1979, when he abducted a 20-year-old Marine named Donnie Harold Crissell. His body was thrown from a moving vehicle onto the 405 freeway. The cause of death was listed as acute alcohol poisoning, Although rope and burn marks indicated Crystal had been bound and tortured prior to his body being discarded. 2 months later, on August 29, the dismembered body of an unidentified male, estimated to be aged between 18 and 30, was found placed in two trash bags behind a Union 76 gas station in Long Beach. The entry upon Kraft's scorecard simply reading 76 is believed to refer to this victim. Although only the head, torso and left leg of this victim were ever found, this victim, like several others, had had a sock placed inside his rectum. 2 weeks later, on September 14, the body of 20-year-old Gregory Wallace Jolly was found in Lake Arrowhead. Jolly had been emasculated and his head and legs had been severed after death. His personal possessions were later found at Kraft's home. On November 24, 1979, a 15-year-old Santa Ana youth named Jeffrey Sayer is believed to have been abducted and murdered by Kraft. Sayer was last seen at a bus stop in Westminster as he traveled home from a date with his girlfriend. The entry Westminster date on Kraft's scorecard is believed to refer to Sayer. On February 18, 1980, the decapitated body of a 19-year-old Marine named Mark Allen Marsh was found near the Templin Highway. Marsh was last seen hitchhiking towards Buena Park. His hands had also been severed from his body after death. In the summer of 1980, Kraft traveled to the neighboring state of Oregon as part of a contractual assignment delegated to him by his employers. Throughout the duration of his deployment, he resided in a town close to Portland. Before he returned to California in August, he is believed to have claimed a further two victims, both of whom were listed upon his scorecard with cryptic references including the word Portland. The first victim, a 17-year-old Denver youth named Michael Sean O'Fallon, was killed on July 17. O'Fallon had been on a solo hitchhiking trip across the US and Canada prior to his enrollment at college at the time of his murder. He was plied with both alcohol and Valium before he was strangled to death. O'Fallon's nude, hogtied body was discarded 10 miles south of Salem. He was listed upon Kraft's scorecard as Portland, Denver. The following day, Kraft is believed to have killed a man estimated to be aged between 35 and 45 years old whose body was found beside a freeway in the city of Woodburn. This victim, listed as Portland Elk on Kraft's scorecard, had ingested a toxic level of Valium and Tylenol before he was strangled to death with a ligature. On September 3, 1980, 1 month after his return to California from Oregon, the bound body of a 19-year-old Marine named Robert Loggins was found discarded in a trash bag located close to the Ultramarine Air Base. Loggins had last been seen alive by two fellow Marines close to the Pacific Coast Highway on August 23. Photographs, and the negatives, subsequently found in Kraft's possession depict Loggins in Kraft's living room slumped fully clothed on his sofa, apparently intoxicated, and in various nude, pornographic postures. All these pictures depict Loggins with his eyes closed. It is unknown whether the victim was alive or dead at the time they were taken. On April 10, 1981, the body of a 17-year-old youth named Michael Cluck was found beside the Interstate 5 freeway close to the community of Gosson, Oregon. Cluck had been abducted as he hitchhiked from Kent, Washington, to Bakersfield, California, the day prior to his body being discovered. The youth had been killed by 31 blows to the head, each inflicted by a blunt instrument which had destroyed the rear of his cranium. In addition, Cluck had been sodomized and his body savagely beaten, kicked and scoured. Cluck is believed to have been recorded upon Kraft's scorecard as Portland Blood, due to the extensive blood and debris found at the murder scene. At the time of the murder, Kraft is known to have again been deployed by his employers to Oregon. In addition, on the day Cluck's body was discovered, Kraft is also known to have visited Elaine County Hospital to receive treatment for a bruised foot. 4 months after Cluck's murder, on August 20, 1981, the partially clothed body of 17-year-old male prostitute Christopher Allen Williams was found in the San Bernardino Mountains. Williams had been plied with both phenobarbital and benzodiazepine and was found with tissue paper lodged deep in his nostrils, causing the youth to choke to death on his own mucus. By early 1982, the relationship between Kraft and Selig had become marred by frequent fights and episodes of temporary separation. In an effort to resolve their personal differences, the couple began attending weekly counseling sessions in Huntington Beach. These sessions began on June 22, 1982. Following complaints from residents of Echo Park regarding a foul odor emanating from the direction of the Hollywood Freeway on July 29, 1982, a Caltrans employee found the decaying body of a 14-year-old Pittsburgh youth named Raymond Davis discarded alongside the Rampart Boulevard or Ramp. Rudimentary efforts had been made to conceal Davis's body beneath leaves and soil. He had last been seen alive in Echo Park on June 17, searching for his missing dog. The youth's wrists had been knotted behind his back in much the same manner as victim Michael O'Fallon had been 2 years previously, and he had been strangled to death with his own shoelace. The entry upon Kraft's scorecard reading dog is believed to refer to Davis. Just 40 feet from Davis' body, the same Caltrans crew also found the body of 16-year-old Robert Evler. Evler had been missing since July 21, although his body was also markedly decomposed. He had been strangled to death with a length of stereo speaker wire. Kraft is not known to have killed again until November 1, 1982, when he abducted and murdered a 24-year-old Modesto man named Unmikey Lane. Lane was last seen hitchhiking towards Orange County in search of work. His body was not found until January 1984, discarded on a hillside close to the town of Ramona. 4 weeks after Lane's murder, the semi-nude body of 26-year-old Brian Witcher was dumped from a moving vehicle alongside the Interstate 5 freeway, close to the city of Wilsonville, Oregon. Witcher had ingested high levels of both alcohol and Valium, but he died of asphyxiation. On December 3, 1982, a 29-year-old carpenter named Anthony Jose Silveira disappeared while hitchhiking towards Medford. His body was found 2 weeks later, strangled, sodomized and bearing evidence of having been violated with foreign objects prior to his murder. At the time of the murders of both Witcher and Silveira, Kraft was again known to have been in Oregon on a business trip, which concluded the day of Silveira's death. On December 4, Kraft is known to have driven from Portland to Seattle to visit friends. Throughout this brief visit, he was observed wearing a military jacket inscribed with the name Silveira. On December 5, Kraft flew from Seattle to Grand Rapids, Michigan, again on business. 2 days after his arrival in Grand Rapids, Kraft encountered cousins Dennis Alt and Christopher Sernborn as their trio attended a seminar in the Amway Grand Plaza Hotel. Kraft was observed conversing with the pair at the reception area of the hotel shortly before midnight. Their bodies were discovered on December 9 in an open field close to the hotel. Both victims had been plied with alcohol and Valium prior to their sodomy and murder, and the bodies had been arranged in sexually suggestive positions. Alt, aged 24, had died of asphyxiation, whereas Sernborn, aged 20, had been strangled to death with his own belt. In addition, a ballpoint pen had been inserted into Sernborn's urethra prior to his murder. Both victims were recorded upon Kraft's scorecard in a single entry reading GR2. A set of keys belonging to Sernborn, plus Silveira's military jacket, were left by Kraft in the hotel. On December 8, Kraft traveled from Michigan to Portland. Within 24 hours of his return to Oregon, he had killed a 19-year-old hitchhiker named Lance Tags. Tags had last been seen hitchhiking from the city of Tucker to the home of a relative in Los Angeles on December 8. His body was discovered the following day, discarded alongside a rural road in Clackamas County, close to where the body of Witcher had been found just 2 weeks earlier. As had been the case with Alt and Sernborn, Tags had been plied with alcohol and Valium prior to his murder, although Tags had died of suffocation caused by a sock thrust into his trachea. noting the passage of time between periods of activity when bodies of young males had been found discarded near mass transportation with alcohol and/or pharmaceuticals in their bloodstream in Oregon. Investigators theorized that their killer resided in another state and struck in Oregon only when they're on business. Following the murders of Silveira, Witcher and Daggs, Oregon investigators relayed details of the murders to police in other states, describing the modus operandi of the killer they were seeking and requesting feedback from any police force who had unsolved murders of young males on their files with similar characteristics. A response from Southern California counties was swift. The pattern of killings was identical to victims linked to the unknown killer in California. The six Oregon murders committed by Kraft were thus linked to the murders he had committed in California. Kraft did not kill again until January 27, 1983, when he abducted a 21-year-old hitchhiker named Derek Church. The victim was last seen alive hitchhiking from Orange County to Sacramento the day prior to his murder. His body was found discarded alongside I-605. An autopsy concluded Church had ingested high levels of alcohol and Valium and had been sodomized. Rope marks on Church's wrists indicated he had struggled against his restraints before he died of a combination of ligature strangulation and numerous blows to the side of his skull inflicted by a blunt instrument. On February 12, Kraft killed two Buena Park men, 18-year-old Jeffrey Nelson and 20-year-old Roger Duvall. The two young men were last seen outside the house of a friend named Bryce Wilson shortly after midnight, informing Wilson they intended to purchase something to eat. Nelson's nude body was found alongside an ramp close to the Garden Grove Freeway several hours after he and Duvall were last seen. He had been emasculated, strangled and thrown from a moving vehicle. Duvall's body was found the following day, discarded down a mountainside close to Mount Baldy in San Bernardino County. He had been bound, sodomized and strangled with a cord. As had been the case with Nelson, Duvall had ingested both alcohol and propranolol prior to his murder. In addition, both victims had ingested both potato skins and grapes shortly before their murder. At 1:10 a.m. on May 14, 1983, two California Highway Patrol officers observed a Toyota Celica driving erratically on Interstate 5 in the Orange County community of Mission Viejo. Observing the vehicle perform an illegal lane change, the officers, suspecting the driver was drunk, signaled for the vehicle to stop. The driver slowed the vehicle to a halt and exited the car, discarding the contents of a beer bottle onto the pavement as he did so. Officer Michael Sterling met the individual, who identified himself as Randy Kraft, at the front of his patrol car and observed that his jeans were unbuttoned. Sterling had Kraft perform a sobriety test, which he failed. Sterling arrested Kraft for driving while intoxicated. Sterling's partner, Sergeant Michael Howard, approached the Celica and observed a young man slumped with his eyes closed in the vehicle passenger seat, partially covered by a jacket. Several empty Moosehead beer bottles and an open prescription bottle of lorazepam tablets were strewn around his feet. Howard attempted to wake the man. Receiving no response to his verbal efforts, Howard attempted to rouse the man by shaking his arm, only to note the individual had a low body temperature. Upon feeling for a pulse, Howard noted the man was dead, with a ligature mark visibly encircling his neck. Lifting the jacket from the victim's lap, Howard noted the victim's jeans had been opened to expose his genitalia. In addition, the victim's hands had been bound with a shoelace and his wrists bore evidence of welt marks. Later identified as Terry Lee Gambrell, a 25-year-old Marine stationed at Elter Air Base, the victim had been strangled to death. Kraft was initially charged with driving under the influence of alcohol, and was held in custody as detectives conducted a thorough search of his vehicle. Upon the rear seat of the car, investigators found a belt, the width of which matched the bruising around Gambrell's neck. Other incriminating evidence included alcohol, tranquilizers, various prescription drugs and stimulants. The passenger seat and carpet of the vehicle was heavily bloodstained, however, Gambrell had no open wounds. The upholstery was removed for forensic analysis, the results of which confirmed the blood was human. Beneath the carpet, investigators discovered an envelope containing over 50 pictures of young men in pornographic poses. Many of the subjects in the pictures appeared either asleep or dead. Inside the trunk, investigators found a ring binder containing a handwritten list of coded notations. A search of Kraft's home revealed further incriminating evidence, including clothes and personal possessions of numerous young men who had been murdered over the last decade. Fibers taken from a rug matched those found upon victim Scott Hughes. In addition, the couch in Kraft's living room was identified as being the one in the photographs found in Kraft's car. The coded list of 61 neatly printed terms and phrases found in Kraft's car is believed to refer to each of Kraft's victims. Many entries appear innocuous, but each is believed to refer to a specific murder victim or double murder. Several entries clearly refer to victims' names. For example, the entry reading EDM refers to the initials of victim Edward Daniel Moore, whereas Vince M refers to victim Vincent Mesters. In other instances, entries indicate torture or mutilation inflicted upon victims' bodies and/or places they were last seen. The entry Marinehead BP, for example, is believed to refer to victim Mark Marsh, a Marine found decapitated having last been seen hitchhiking towards Buena Park. Other entries simply refer to body dump locations. The entry Golden Sales, for example, refers to the fact the body of Craig Jonatus was found in the parking lot of the Golden Sales Hotel. The list also contains entries indicating a minimum of 4 double murders, GR2, victims Dennis Alt and Christopher Sernborn, last seen in Grand Rapids, 2-in-1 Beach, victims Jeffrey Nelson and Roger Duvall, 2-in-1 Hitch and 2-in-1 Megavolt to PL, neither entry of which has been linked to any double murder or disappearance. Investigators contend that two victims of whose murders Kraft was convicted, Church and Gambrell, are not listed on Kraft's scorecard. However, since the list is in code, the possibility exists that Church in particular is actually included on the scorecard as an entry which investigators cannot recognize as referring to him. Gambrell may also be included on the list, although as Kraft was arrested while he attempted to dispose of the body, he may not have recorded an entry referring to Gambrell on his scorecard. These possibilities indicate the scorecard lists a minimum of 65 and possibly a total of 67 victims. The entry upon Kraft's scorecard reading Navy White is believed by investigators to refer to a 17-year-old named James Sean Cox, an apprentice medic stationed at Mather Air Force Base who was last seen on September 29, 1974. Hitchhiking near Interstate 5 and whose body was found several weeks later in Rancho Santa Fe. At the time of his disappearance, Cox was dressed in his white Navy uniform. In addition to the color of his uniform, Cox was a blonde youth. A further entry on Kraft's scorecard, simply reading Iowa, is believed to refer to an 18-year-old Marine named Oral Alfred Stewart, Jr., who had been born in Iowa. His body was found discarded close to a Long Beach condominium on November 10, 1974. The man had died as a result of blunt force trauma. His body remained unidentified until March 2012. Investigators note a similar modus operandi in the murder and body disposal of Stewart to that of the victims Kraft is known to have killed. 22 of Kraft's estimated 67 victims remain unrecovered and unidentified. This is due in part to the killings having occurred throughout several states, and with bodies being discarded in varying locations. On May 16, 1983, Kraft was formally charged with the murder of Gambrell. By September 8, investigators had interviewed over 700 witnesses and had gathered more than 250 physical exhibits which pointed towards Kraft's guilt in a further 15 homicides committed between December 1972 and February 1983. He was formally charged with these 15 murders, in addition to 2 counts of sodomy and 1 of emasculation, on this date.